Hello everyone and a very good morning to all of you. Welcome back once again to session of PIB 247. मैं हूं मनीष मिश्रा and in today's session as usually guys we are going to discuss some more questions from the PIB news which are important for the ESI section of RBI Great Beyond NABARD. But guys before we begin most of the students are asking this question that how many months of current affairs should be covered before the exam. So if we talk about the phase 1 then you should cover 6 to 8 months current affair before the exam. While talking about the phase 2 you should go for 1 year current affairs or at least 8 to 10 months. If you are covering 8 to 10 months for the phase 2 then that would also be considered as a good preparation. But in my opinion you should go for 1 year current affairs. Okay. So this is the answer to all those questions. Alright. So let's begin with the session. But before we begin if you are coming here for the first time do subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon. You can also join this Telegram group for updated information regarding the daily sessions and also regarding the courses. So let's talk about the very first question which is about the not-for-profit hospital model. Question is which of the following is incorrect according to Niti Aayog's study on the not-for-profit hospital model in the country. Remember guys the private hospitals in our country, jo hamare desh ke private hospitals hain, these are divided into two types of private hospitals are there. Number one are the for-profit hospitals. For-profit hospital and number two are the not-for-profit hospitals. And remember these not-for-profit hospitals are impaneled under the state government or any other central government. Okay. So let's talk about this report of Niti Aayog. So remember the Niti Aayog has released a comprehensive study on the not-for-profit hospital model in the country. And this has been done to close the information gap on such institutions and facilitating the robust policy making in this area, because we all know that not-for-profit hospitals are not doing that much good in the area of medical and healthcare. Now talking about this report, so if you talk about the number of patients in the for-profit and not-for-profit, so the not-for-profit hospitals account for only 1.1% of treated ailments as of June 2018. While talking about the inpatients, if we talk about the inpatients, so the not-for-profit hospitals account for only 2.7% of inpatients in the country, while for-profit hospitals account for 55.3% of inpatient, while the rest inpatient move to the government hospitals. Remember these two types of hospital which are for-profit and not-for-profit are the types of private hospitals. Alright. Now the not-for-profit hospitals use various levers to facilitate their low cost of clinical care. So they are using various strategies to facilitate the low cost of clinical care, like for example they are using multitasking of workforce. Okay, they are involving workforce in the multitask and they are doing in-house manufacturing of equipment such as beds, dental chairs, etc. Jo bhi medical equipments jo in-house manufacturing kiya ja sakta hai, they are doing their in-house manufacturing to reduce their cost of clinical care. Alright. Now talking about the charges, so the not-for-profit hospitals are charging very much lower cost than the for-profit hospital. Like for example, if you talk about the cumulative cost of care, that is 1/4 of the for-profit hospital. Talking about the package component, of course, that's 20% less than the for-profit hospital. Doctors or the surgeons charges 36% less. Bed charges 44% less, while cost of medicine is 26% less. So these are the charges, these are the reduced charges that are being charged by the not-for-profit hospitals if we compare it with the for-profit hospitals. Now this table you don't have to remember, ye yaad rakhne ki koi zarurat nahi hai, this is just for the basic understanding. All right. Now there are some challenges also. Of course there must be some challenges because they are the not-for-profit hospitals. So talking about the recruitment, so most of these not-for-profit hospitals finds difficult to recruit and retain the doctors and staff. It is very difficult to recruit them and once recruited it is very difficult to retain them because of course less salary, less emoluments, less facilities to the doctors and the staff. Talking about the reimbursement, so there are delayed reimbursements and long pending amounts despite their persistence causing strain in their cash flows. Unka jo cash flow hai wo bigad jata hai jiski wajah se उनका जो ऑपरेशन है उसके ऊपर बर्डन आने लगता है. राइट. एंड रिमेंबर मेनी ऑफ दीज हॉस्पिटल्स आर डिपेंडेंट ऑन एक्सटर्नल फंडिंग बिकॉज दे आर नॉट फॉर प्रॉफिट हॉस्पिटल, सो दे हैव टू डिपेंड ऑन द एक्सटर्नल फंडिंग फॉर देयर ऑपरेटिंग एक्सपेंसेस. ओके. एंड देर आर सम रेगुलेटरी चैलेंजेस ऑल्सो बिकॉज मोस्ट ऑफ दीज हॉस्पिटल्स विच आर इन दी remote areas, they find they you know face challenges because of the high compliance burden under various acts like Clinical Establishment Act of 2010, PCPNDT Act of 1994 and other quality standards acts. Okay, so these are some of the challenges that these hospitals face. Now, what are the suggestions how we can improve these not-for-profit hospitals? Because we know, guys, जो हमारा हेल्थ सेक्टर है वो एक सोशल सेक्टर से रिलेटेड है. सो वी हैव टू सो वी शुड प्रमोट द नॉट फॉर प्रॉफिट हॉस्पिटल सो दैट द ट्रीटमेंट कैन बी प्रोवाइडेड एट द अफोर्डेबल कॉस्ट टू ऑल द सिटीजन. सो नंबर वन इज दैट देर इज अ नीड ऑफ शॉर्ट एंड लॉन्ग टर्म पॉलिसी इंटरवेंशन इन दीज हॉस्पिटल्स. द डोनेशन पे जो टैक्स लगता है उसको एग्जेम्प्ट कर देना चाहिए. द टैक्सेस ऑन द डोनेशन शुड बी एग्जेम्प्टेड बाय द गवर्नमेंट. देन The expertise of these not-for-profit hospitals should be used in managing human resources with limited finances in remote areas, and they should be provided with the working capital loans with lower interest rates so that they are able to manage their operating expenses. All right. So this is about this report, and now let's come back to the question. You have to identify the incorrect statement regarding this study. So the not-for-profit hospitals charge lower than the for-profit hospitals. Of course, this is absolutely correct. Most of the not-for-profit hospitals are empaneled with the state or central government healthcare schemes. This is also correct. Most of the hospitals find it difficult to recruit and retain the doctors and staff. Yes, because of the low emoluments and facilities. There is a weak focus on quality care across all categories of not-for-profit hospitals. No, this is incorrect because they are focusing on the quality care. There is a strong focus on the quality care of quality healthcare. So this must be the incorrect statement. Option D will be the correct answer. And many of these hospitals are dependent on the external funding that we have discussed. Okay. So option D, guys, here is the correct answer. And now let's move ahead to question number 2. The first fintech cohort of the Atal Innovation Mission. So Atal Innovation Mission ne bahut utpad machaya hua hai. Matlab har mahine ek aadhi news to Atal Innovation Mission ki aati hi hai. But hum kya kar sakte hain? Hame to padhna hi padega. So the first fintech cohort of the AIM was concluded in the month of June 2021 for bringing together the startups, enterprises, investors and financiers. So you have to just name the cohort. So remember, the name of the cohort is AIM ILEAP program. AIM ILEAP program, you must have heard of this program, AIM ILEAP. So this was the first fintech cohort of Atal Innovation Mission under this program, which is known as AIM ILEAP. All right. Talking more about this, so ILEAP stands for Innovative Leadership for Entrepreneurial Agility and Profitability. Now, this was organized to push startups in the country by bringing together all the startups, all the enterprises, investors and financiers for further partnership. Partnership ke liye in sabhi ko ek saath lana is program ka objective tha, is program ka aim tha. Okay. And if we talk about the broader objective of this program, that is to invite technology startups across a broad range of area. Alag-alag areas se startups ko invite kiya gaya and unko saath mein laake partnership ke liye promote kiya gaya. They were encouraged for partnership. Okay. And there were two partners in this, Rezo and Visa. Rezo and Visa are the partner, which means this program was organized in collaboration with Rezo and Visa. Okay. So, इसमें इतना ही पढ़ना है, इससे ज्यादा पढ़ने की जरूरत नहीं है. सो AIM ILEAP प्रोग्राम इज द करेक्ट आंसर, ऑप्शन डी. एंड नाउ लेट्स मूव अहेड टू क्वेश्चन नंबर 3, विच इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन. विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग स्टेटमेंट्स इज नॉट करेक्ट विद रिगार्ड टू रिवैम्ड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन सेक्टर स्कीम. सो गवर्नमेंट इज डूइंग अ लॉट फॉर रिवाइविंग द डिस्कॉम्स, द डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन कंपनीज इन द इलेक्ट्रिसिटी सेक्टर. सो दिस इज वन ऑफ द स्टेप अगेन टू रिवाइव द डिस्कॉम, द डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन कंपनीज, द डिस्कॉम्स. ओके, let's talk about this. So the news is that the Union Cabinet has approved the revamped distribution sector scheme with an aim to strengthen the supply infrastructure of the distribution companies. Jo distribution companies hai unke supply infrastructure ko strengthen karne ke liye this scheme has been launched with a total outlay of ₹3,03,758 crores, a huge amount. 3,03,758 crores will be the total outlay of this scheme. Now remember, this financial assistance to strengthen the supply infrastructure will be based on meeting the pre-qualifying criteria. There are certain pre-qualifying criteria, and also there are some minimum benchmarks that have to be achieved by the DISCOMs to have this financial assistance. And remember, this minimum benchmarks and the pre-qualifying criteria will be evaluated on the basis of agreed evaluation framework by the ministry. Okay. Now talking about the duration, so its duration will be up to the financial year 2026 and total 25 crore smart meters are planned to be installed during the 5 years. अगले 5 सालों में 25 crore smart meters लगाए जाएंगे. Okay, and remember one important thing that each state would have its own action plan for the implementation of this particular scheme, which means there is no one size fits all approach that will be followed under the implementation of this scheme. Okay, so each state will be independent to have their own action plan for the implementation of this scheme. Now remember, the scheme proposes to subsume the ongoing schemes of IPDS, DDU-GGY and PMDP, which is Prime Minister's Development Program, Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Gram Jyoti Yojana and Integrated Power Development Scheme. And remember, this Prime Minister Development Program is exclusively for the Jammu Kashmir and Ladakh region. And remember, the very important thing that the nodal agencies for implementation of this scheme is the Rural Electrification Corporation and PFC, which is Power Finance Corporation. Alright. Now talking about the main focus. So remember, this is very important. The main focus of this scheme will be on improving electricity supply for the farmers and to provide them daytime electricity through solarization of agricultural feeders. जो agricultural feeders है उनका solarization करके उनको day time में light दी जाएगी. And जो major focus होगा वो basically किसके ऊपर होगा? Electricity supply to the farmers. Now there are some targets of the scheme as well. Reduction of AT&C losses, which is nothing but the operational losses. Now AT&C losses means operational losses due to the inefficient use of power supply. So the reduction of AT&C, AT&C stands for aggregate, technical and commercial. Remember this also, aggregate, technical and commercial, which in simple words is known as operational losses due to inefficient use of power supply. So it will be reduced up to the level of 12-15% by the year 2024-25 and reduction of cost revenue gap to zero by the year 2024-25. So do remember the targets. These are the very, very important. All right. So this was about this scheme, guys, and now let's come back to the question. You have to identify incorrect statement once again. So the scheme would be available till the financial year 2026. Absolutely correct. It aims at strengthening supply infrastructure of DISCOMs. Yes. The scheme will have an outlay of ₹3,03,758 crores. This is also correct. Private DISCOMs are also included under the scheme. So remember, this is incorrect. Private DISCOMs are not included under the scheme. Only the public sector distribution companies will be included to get the benefit under this scheme. So option D will be the correct answer because private DISCOMs will not be included under this scheme. Alright. And now let's move ahead to question number 4. This is again about a very important scheme that has been launched recently. So cabinet approved the loan guarantee scheme for COVID affected sectors to provide financial guarantee cover for brownfield expansion and greenfield projects related to which sector? कौन से सेक्टर के लिए दिस लोन गारंटी स्कीम हैज बीन लॉन्च्ड? एंड रिमेंबर, ब्राउन फील्ड सेक्टर्स आर दोज विच आर द ऑनगोइंग प्रोजेक्ट्स. द ऑनगोइंग प्रोजेक्ट्स आर नोन एज द ब्राउन फील्ड प्रोजेक्ट्स, व्हाइल द न्यू प्रोजेक्ट्स आर नोन एज द ग्रीन फील्ड प्रोजेक्ट्स. दिस इज द बेसिक डिफरेंस बिटवीन दीज टू टर्म्स. ओके, सो रिमेंबर, दिस लोन गारंटी स्कीम फॉर कोविड अफेक्टेड सेक्टर हैज बीन लॉन्च्ड फॉर health and the medical infrastructure, and this has been launched for both brownfield projects and the greenfield projects also. Now this has been, guys, done because obviously we have seen jo hospital ke upar pressure pada tha itna zyada, jo hospital ke infrastructure jo hai almost jo hai wo fail ho gaya tha, to usko tackle karne ke liye taki in future is tarike ki problem se ko tackle kiya ja sake easily, this has been launched. So this has been launched to upscale the medical infrastructure in the country, स्पेसिफिकली टारगेटिंग द underserved areas. ओके, जैसे विलेज और रूरल एरियाज है वहां पे ज्यादा फोकस किया जाएगा. द टोटल फंडिंग अंडर दिस प्रोजेक्ट अंडर दिस स्कीम विल बी 50,000 crores एंड द स्कीम वुड बी एप्लीकेबल अप टू द 31st March 2022 और टिल द अमाउंट ऑफ ₹50,000 crore इज सैंक्शनड, विच एवर इज अर्लियर. या तो 31st March 2022 या जब तक ₹50,000 crore सैंक्शन नहीं हो जाते, दोनों में से जो पहले हो जाएगा तब तक के लिए ये स्कीम एप्लीकेबल होगी. राइट. Now, how much loan guarantee will be provided? So remember, a guarantee of 50% for brownfield projects and 75% for greenfield projects will be provided up to a loan of ₹100 crores. And this is for the medical infrastructure which will be set up at the urban or rural locations other than 8 metropolitan tier 1 cities, which are also known as classic cities. While if you talk about the aspirational districts, so for the aspirational district, the guarantee cover for both the brownfield and the greenfield projects will be 75%. All right. Now, what is the meaning of this loan guarantee? So let us say 100 crore loan is provided to a particular project. Okay, 100 crore loan is provided to a particular project. Then out of this 100 crores, 50 crores guarantee will be provided by the government, that in the case of failure of this project, 50 crore will be returned by the government of India to that particular bank. Okay, jisne bhi ye 100 crore ka loan diya hai. Okay, so this is the meaning of this loan guarantee. So guys, therefore the correct answer should be the health or the medical infrastructure. Option C will be the correct answer, to revive the health or medical infrastructure, to provide financial assistance, to provide the loan guarantee to the health or medical infrastructure. This loan guarantee scheme has been launched by the government of India. Option C will be the correct answer. And now let's move ahead to question number 5, which is the last question for today. What is the new deadline for registration under the Atmanirbhar Bharat Rozgar Yojana, जो कि 2020 में लॉन्च हुई थी अंडर द आत्मनिर्भर पैकेज 3.0. इफ यू ऑल रिमेंबर दैट वी हैव कवर्ड दिस स्कीम वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिवली, आत्मनिर्भर भारत रोजगार योजना दैट वाज लॉन्च इन द थर्ड पैकेज ऑफ आत्मनिर्भर भारत. सो द क्वेश्चन इज, व्हाट इज द न्यू डेडलाइन फॉर द रजिस्ट्रेशन अंडर द स्कीम. सो रिमेंबर द डेडलाइन हैज बीन एक्सटेंडेड फ्रॉम 30th जून 2021 टू 31st मार्च 2022. एंड रिमेंबर that this scheme is being implemented through Employees Provident Fund Organization, and the basic objective of this scheme is to reduce the financial burden on the employers of various sectors or the industries and to encourage them to hire more and more workers, which will give a boost to the employment. Now, what is the estimated expenditure? Now, if we include the extended period now, then the total estimated expenditure will be 22,098 crores. Okay. And it is expected that it will create 71.8 lakh employment in the upcoming future. Now talking about this Atmanirbhar Bharat Rozgar Yojana, so as we have discussed that it was launched to boost the employment in formal sector and to incentivize the creation of new employment opportunities during the COVID phase, and it was launched under the third package of Atmanirbhar Bharat. All right. Now, what is the basic, modus operandi kya hai is scheme ki, kis tarike se ye scheme mein kaam hoga. So remember, the government of India will provide subsidy for 2 years in respect of new employees engaged on or after 1st October 2020 and up to 31st March 2022. Now earlier this date was of course 30th June 2021. Now this date is 31st March 2022. So the government will provide subsidy for a period of 2 years. Now, what kind of subsidy is this? What kind of subsidy the government will provide? So remember, if there is an establishment which has a number of employees up to 1,000, then for that particular establishment, government of India will pay both 12% employees contribution and 12% employers contribution towards the PF. That is 24% of wages towards EPF for a period of 2 years. And remember the beneficiary of this scheme will be those employees who have salaries or wages less than 15,000. Okay, 15,000 se kam walon ke liye bas ye. And talking about for the establishment employing more than 1,000 employees, then the government of India will pay employee share of 12%. Employees ka jo share hai 12%, wo pay kiya jayega 12% of wages in respect of new employees for a period of 2 years. And as I told you, any new employee joining employment in EPF or registered establishment on monthly wages less than rupees 15,000 will be the beneficiary under this scheme. All right. So therefore, guys, the correct answer should be 31st March 2022. Option A will be the correct answer, because the new deadline for the registration under this scheme is 31st March 2022. All right. So that's it for the session, guys. I hope all the questions are clear. If you have any doubts, you can ask me in the comment section. Thank you so much for watching. Goodbye. Take care and God bless.